Well, I'm sure Carl will be here in a moment, but let's go ahead and get started. We'll begin with a prayer and a pledge of allegiance. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for a new day, and we just ask you now to come and preside over this meeting, giving us guidance and direction on each individual agenda item. Give us the wisdom to make the right decision, what is best for the citizens of Titus County. We thank you for those who serve the county. We thank you for those who serve the city, for our law enforcement, our first responders. We just ask for your protection over them at all times while they are on the job. Also be with our servicemen and servicewomen, wherever they might be. Lord, bring them home safely. We thank you for Titus County and for our citizens and those that support the work of this county. We just again turn the meeting over to you now. In Christ's name, amen.
Amen.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. All right, welcome everyone to our first meeting of the month of April 2016, and it is the 11th day of April and just a couple of minutes after 9 a.m. We will begin with item number one, public comments, requests for information on non-agenda items. In accordance with Section 551.042, Texas Open Meetings Act, anyone has anything they would like to address the court regarding at this time? All right, moving along. Item two, consider and possibly approve the minutes from a March 17th special meeting of the Commissioner's Court. This was an executive session meeting. There was no other agenda items on that particular agenda.
Judge, I'd like to motion for the minutes of that meeting.
Thank you. Commissioner Hinton makes the motion.
Second.
Second by Commissioner Parker for approval of those minutes from that special meeting. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Item number three, consider and possibly approve minutes from our March 28th meeting. This was our second meeting of the month of March on the 28th. Thank you. Commissioner Hinton makes the motion.
Second.
Second by Commissioner Fields. All in favor of approval say aye.
Aye.
Thank you, Joyce, for doing those minutes. Item number four is a presentation by Chris Durant. Chris is our constable for precincts 1, 3, and 4, and he's got something super secret here. Pull that mic down a little bit, would you? There you go.
Okay, I'm here today.
Yep.
I'm here to get today to give thanks and recognition to Harold Connor for his service with Titus County Reserve Deputy. Harold recently had his 25th service anniversary with Titus County. Harold has served as a reserve deputy for Titus County Sheriff's Office from 88 to 2001 and through my office from 2002 to present. He's given thousands of hours, literally thousands of hours, in the service of Titus County. Harold received his basic reserve training through East Texas Police Academy in 1988. Sheriff Moss added him to his department in patrol as a backup reserve deputy. In 2002, I was fortunate to be able to add Harold to my office. He gives 16 to 20 hours a week consistently as a deputy and assists my office in warrant service, justice courtroom security, civil process, prisoner transport. He assists on patrol as backup to the sheriff's department, to the police department, to the troopers. He's out there just like everybody else. He's a first responder in the northern part of the county also. In addition to assisting my office, Deputy Connor fills in as bailiff in district court and county court and assists the county attorney's office when investigator Lindsay has to be out. He assists in some of his duties also through the county attorney's office. Deputy Connor receives probably 20 hours a year in additional training, just like every other peace officer. Deputy Connor serves with dedication and professionalism and has the same authority as any other peace officer out here when he's called to duty. All I describe about him, he does as a volunteer, strictly volunteer basis. And at this time, I'd like to present with this flag.
Could I come down there and get a picture? Oh, Valerie, do you have a camera? You got your camera with you. Why don't you pose them however you would like? It would make a nice picture. Yeah, let's do that. Can we come down there? Yeah, let's come down here.
Let's go down.
It says, "Present to Harold W. Conner sincere appreciation, recognition for 25 years of dedicated service to the citizens of Titus County." Excellent. 25 years.
Years is a long time for a paid position, much less a volunteer position. Harold, we appreciate you, Harold. Thank you. Thank you, Chris. Item number 5 is consider and possibly approve repairs to the parking lot at the Ag Extension offices on Industrial. Kenny, tell us what you need out there.
Pretty familiar with that, and I believe all of you have probably helped me patch over time little areas, but as time's gone on, we really appreciate the support that y'all have had out there. But there's starting to be some erosion, that type of thing. And for our older clientele that volunteer negotiate that, it's we don't want it to become a problem. And I Mr. Phil Commissioner, y'all might have been there when they built that kind of thing. It's held up for 20 years. I mean, we just kind of patched, but I was wondering whether maybe we could get it bladed, if that would be sufficient, or whether do you think we need to bring something in. It's really not bad yet, but, and like I said, it's held up for a long time, but we're starting to get people, you know, a little unstable out there when they're working and things like that. But I appreciate everybody that's helped us patch it and knows, but I don't know, what are your thoughts on that? Whether we really need repairs, if we do, I mean, or could it just be bladed? And I don't know who.
What kind of base is out there? I mean, it looks like dirt and some shavings like I put in my garden.
It's hard.
That's where they dump the shavings and stuff that's been pushed back into that pile. But it's a rock base.
It's a rock base.
Commissioner, don't fill that in.
They just got
the thing is, it's just like on that back page, you probably don't realize that building is 7,000 square feet. Half of that building, we calculate that during rainwater catchment. There's 163,000 gallons runs across that parking lot this last year because we had 77 inches of rain. Now that's just 1 year, but over 20 years, it has really held up well. But I think it's time we just kind of get it laid or whatever you think. Y'all are more familiar with the base that lies there, but I didn't know whether I need to allocate something that comes out of my budget to have somebody go over there and lay it, or how that works.
When's the last time that we did any kind of work on it?
Well, in the past, I mean, I've had each individual commissioner's, you know, patched a hole for it. I don't think I've ever had any.
It's been a while since it's been bladed on.
Sir?
I say it's been a while since it's been bladed.
Well, I feel like if we don't lose the base that's under there, it's held up very well, but you start to see that there are starting to be some wash issues out there. I don't think if we get to it fairly quick, I don't think it's going to be much of an issue.
Is it possible to put a drain pipe underneath the ground somewhere out there to get it off the building?
Oh, sure. The two, or I guess there's actually three downspouts together, have a French drain or something underneath to go all the way out. That's just half of it. On the south side of the building, we actually have a rainwater catchment out of one, but you can't catch all that water. I mean, Every inch of rain, for an inch of rain, 7,000 square feet, it's going to be 0.6 gallons, so that's going to be a little over 3,500 gallons. So you got to run it off, or you got to do something like that. It's just not feasible for INVOCATION, even though that's a politically correct thing to do, is try to gather the water. We have an administration like that. We'd have to dig a pond to catch all the water off of that.
Now, there is a French drain down the front, isn't there?
Yeah.
We have a French drain across the front of the building. We have water that run in there, the master gardeners. Yeah, we dug down. We had to back all the things out there, put rock down in front of the sidewalk. Yeah, that's not an issue at all. That's a sloped area, and of course, there's a lot more activity now with the gardens and things out there.
What we did on this, Judge, we put iron or gravel about 6 inches to 7 inches deep, and then we come back and put ground up asphalt, and it's really held up pretty good over the years. Now, the wood that you see here, this is where we have people, tree trimmers and people like this, and they mulch that up and they bring it in, and y'all give it to people that want it.
Well, that's what that is. We use that in our gardens.
In the garden, too.
Things like that. Some of the demonstrations that we have ongoing, hurricane demonstrations, the roses there, the ones out of Sugar Hill. We actually have two hurricane grape demonstrations. There's only three in the state. We've got two of them here in Titus County. That's part of that, using the resources that are available to us, so there's no cost. But it's been a very good base there. I just hate to see it's kind of like a gopher run. That can start an erosion issue and things like that. So you're more familiar with what needs to be done, but
Does it need more material in addition to the blading?
Yeah, it does. It wouldn't hurt to have some. Just take a pair, dump it out, and blade it in.
What kind of material?
What we've got right now is that build up asphalt. I mean, if that would be sufficient.
I volunteered Philip to grade it, and I'll help dig the ditch, and
I'll
if
get
we
you
put
to haul
a
it.
Drain in there, then it wouldn't go across the parking lot.
Wait a second now. Wait a minute.
Philip can do it.
But I didn't know in the past everybody's kind of contributed, but I didn't know at this time to try to get it bladed, whether if there's resources like that, I need to ask for that and come out of my side of the budget, or how we do that, or those kinds of things.
The land belongs to the county and county extension office, and we've always, you know, went back for, like I said, the wood pulp here that's on the ground is just where we've used this, and it was piled over there, but you can see the little ditch coming down through there, and it has held up well for 20
It drops years. Off toward the back. I don't think it's in that picture, and that's kind of where the big pile of mulch is, but that gets raked up, picked up. It's really not a layer of mulch there in the parking lot part.
Yeah. Right.
But Philip, you just be in charge of it, and we'll all help.
Okay.
Yeah. Philip's equipment and my equipment's real close. I mean, just around the corner. And Philip supervised. I'll help with some equipment.
We'll get you fixed up.
Okay. I appreciate it. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Kenny. This is an action item, so let's have a motion in a second.
I make a motion to approve the repairs on the parking lot.
To be shared between the resources of precincts 1 and 3? Is there anything that 2 and 4 can add to the cause?
All precincts, material or whatever.
Okay. Motion is that Commissioner Hinton will coordinate an effort to be shared by all 4 precincts to make necessary repairs at the Ag Extension Office.
I'll second that.
Second by Commissioner Parker. All in favor of that action, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Item number 6, consider and possibly approve the authorizing the law firm Allison Bass and McGee to commence legal proceedings on behalf of Titus County. It has seemed like nothing has been going on related to our legal matters involving the bridge of the loop that was built too short, but there has been much going on behind the scenes. I believe we're at a point here where we need to take action to authorize Allison Bass, and we did have a conversation with Robert Bass here a few weeks ago, and made the decision to put this on the agenda to authorize them to move forward to the next phase, which may involve possibly filing lawsuit. So I'll need your authorization before they can begin that.
I'll make that motion, Judge.
Commissioner Hinton makes the motion to authorize Allison Bass to commence legal proceedings.
Second.
Second by Commissioner Parker. All in favor, say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Thank you. Item number 7, open review and possibly award for bids for cleaning the exterior of the county courthouse. And then right behind that, we'll talk about caulking and replacing windows. Do we have a bid or bids on this first item, Carl?
The only bid I provided is Richard Jones, and it says power washing, caulking, so
it's all in here. Okay. Yeah, let's go ahead and open it. Okay, so that's the only one that you received. Before I open this and let out his pricing, are you all okay with the fact that we only received this one bid? If you want to rebid it, I don't want to open this bid and disclose what he's priced this at.
Nobody else got anything in?
Yeah. Okay. Move forward. Anybody have a problem with opening it? Otherwise, I'm going to open this.
I do not have a problem with it because everybody had the same opportunity to bid it if they wanted to.
Mr. Jones was the one that volunteered to do the legwork, and in fact, he did put together a bid specs for us that anyone else interested could utilize. So I've got, looks like he's broken this down into two or three phases. I'm going to look for the one. Okay, this is the one that relates to, morning, Troy. This first page is a bid from Richard Jones Construction, and the project is stated as follows. Cleaning the exterior of the courthouse, EFIS, and windows. So I'm not sure what EFIS is other than that material that's on the exterior of the courthouse. So clean the exterior and windows and the concrete retaining walls and steps. So this would include, I guess, any hard surface on the outside of the courthouse, windows, the exterior stucco material or drive it or whatever that material is, he calls it EFIS, the concrete retaining walls and the steps. Workers' comp and general liability included, of course. His bid is $14,500 for that part. Do you have that letter from the state about getting permission to do this? Did I give it to you? Yeah, the one that Steve Austin had initiated. There it is. Steve Austin had brought to my attention that it would be a good idea to get the Texas Historical Commission aware of what we were doing, and so I did notify them. Let me tell you, here's what I asked of them. The Commissioner's Court would like to notify the Commission of our intention to clean the exterior of our courthouse. We have some minor mold issues as well as simple dust and dirt that needs to be cleaned. We anticipate using mild cleaning solution and water along with possible power wash application. We will not be making any modifications, alterations, or applying any new exterior material or paint. They did respond. Thank you for contacting the Texas Historical Commission concerning this proposal to clean the exterior. After reviewing the correspondence referenced, The commission finds no reason to prevent or delay Titus County from cleaning the courthouse using the methods described. And they go on to say, please exercise caution, keep the water pressure not too high, make the cleaning solution as mild as possible, make sure they're biodegradable. If the cleaning solution's left on the building too long, it can soak into the finish and quite likely cause algae or mold. Thank you for the opportunity to review and provide comments. I appreciate your efforts to protect the courthouse. Please contact me if I can be of further assistance. So, there's the bid for the cleaning, exterior cleaning, and obviously this is going to involve scaffolding, power washing, and a good bit of detail time covering every square foot of the exterior of this building. $14,500.
I make a motion, we accept it.
Motion by Commissioner Riddle to accept the one bid from Richard Jones at $14,500 to clean the exterior of the building.
Judge,
sir.
Do you want to pay the
payment? I don't know that we have that choice. Oh, the payment bond. I'm thinking of the performance and the payment bond. That's a good question. It's possible he'll bring in subs to do the power washing or to set up scaffolding. The question is, do you want, and how much did that payment bond cost us across the street on a $60,000 project? $2,200. $2,200 on a $60,000 project. I don't know how much a payment bond would be on this. So, do you want to waive the payment bond? Performance bond we don't need because the project is not high enough, although you could always require a performance bond. But in this case, do you want Mr. Jones to provide you with a payment bond, or are you comfortable enough with his work to waive that?
He does have workman's comp.
He does have comp, and he provides that liability and workers' comp for his employees.
Okay. Would you say it don't qualify for enough? Not that
they don't have to do a performance bond. $50,000.
I don't think we need a performance bond with him.
What about a payment bond? Do you remember the difference? The payment bond ensures that he pays all of his subs.
Yeah, he won't. I don't think he'll use any subs.
Okay.
If he does use subs,
does anybody feel the need for a performance bond? I would like that included in the motion that we're waiving the need for a payment bond on this project at $14,500. Now, if you award him these other things, you know, you may have a bigger project.
He's done different projects. I know he did. He cleaned the outside of the building of the Garrity Bond Bank, and they said he did a great job over there, and he's done other jobs here. And
he obviously doesn't provide payment bonds because that was something new to him when we asked him for one.
Right.
For that small amount of money, I don't think.
Okay, you want to include that in your motion? Motion be to award this without a payment bond.
Waive that.
Second.
Second by Commissioner Fields to award the job of cleaning the exterior of the courthouse by Richard Jones without the requirement of a payment bond. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Thank you. Let's look at item number 8 is open review and possibly award bids for caulking and or replacement of courthouse windows or glass. He's got two additional pages here, so let me tell you what these are. One would be to caulk exterior windows, caulking the exterior windows perimeter on the exterior and grills and exterior doors and cracks in the expansion joints, and remove old caulking before new caulking is installed. His price to do that is $14,975. Again, that's caulking the exterior windows on the perimeter of the exterior, along with the grills and the exterior doors and cracks in the expansion joints, and remove old caulking before new caulking is installed. Mr. Fields, I know you got up there with him and looked at some of this. I don't have any concept of how much work and how much material is needed to do this. Does this sound like a job of that magnitude to you after you looked at it?
Because I know there's some windows that have to be replaced. There's gaps that big. I know that's the reason we've got a water problem on the third floor. And he's talking about taking all the caulking off the windows and replacing it with new. And then
with new caulking, not new windows, because I've got a third bid here to replace actual panes, okay. But it's not replacing the whole window itself.
Right. No, I didn't mean that, but I meant, you know, I know there's one window up there that's just, as they can redo the frame and stuff, it's something's got to be done to that, because that's where our water problem's at. And there's a lot of windows on this courthouse. Also, there was
well over 100.
Yes. But I think it needs to be fixed for the integrity of the building. We need to keep the water out.
Many of these offices also have cool air coming in the wintertime due to a lack of adequate caulking around those windows. And at first, I thought it was just the caulking around the inside, but then when he showed me, you know, where the real source was, it is on the exterior, and it's just worn and fallen off over time. Not a cheap fix. So let me read you, since these are included in the same item, his third page here is to replace insulated window panes. I think the building has 549 panes. I don't know how many need replacing. I will replace at $135 each pane. Now, obviously, not all of those need to be replaced, but some of these have lost their seal, and you do have some condensation in between there. I'd like to have a number of those before we approved that, just so I had some kind of an idea. Now, that doesn't mean that the windows are faulty or that they're bad or that we're going to suffer anything. It's just that they may be visually not as clear as a new pane. So I would like to maybe know.
We looked at several of them. What we're having, especially that not the first window, and I think sometimes the second window, they've lost their vacuum. So moisture builds up inside, you're not able to see outside. Now, there's not all of them have that problem, but there are some out there that do need to be replaced. The vacuum's gone, and you can't even look out the window. But, you know, I think if you want somebody involved in it or whatever, you take Mr. Riddles and me, he can show us the ones that need to be replaced, and we can make a call on them.
These are the windows right here we're talking about.
Yes, sir.
I replaced all of mine in my house.
The panes?
Yeah, because of the
vacuum
insulation.
It's
vacuum.
I got better insulated windows. I don't know, $135 sounds cheap.
What were these insulated with?
Sir?
What were they? Did they have ergon in them or what, Mike? Do you remember? What was inside them?
Moisture between the two windows.
Originally, how old are these windows? Early 90s? Late
94.
94? So they're 20 years old. They were just coming on with gas-filled windows there in the late 90s. It was a brand new thing. So I doubt if these have
91. We finished everything in 94.
Yeah, that was pretty new when I was building a house in 97, so I doubt if there's anything here. Now, could it be in some additional benefit for insulation, perhaps? I think that those could be replaced after the cleaning project. It's, you know, it might be smart to do it while you've got the scaffolding up there. But maybe we could approve those as we went. You know, for every 100 windows you replace, you're looking at $13,500. I don't think we've got 100 windows that need to be replaced.
I'm going to say, just from what I remember seeing and stuff, you're probably looking at
10% of them?
Maybe.
50 windows?
Maybe. I don't think it'd be that many.
Yeah, 50 panes.
50 panes. But see, they can replace the bottom pane, or they can replace the second one, or third one, or fourth. They don't replace the whole thing. It's just the windows.
Right, it's just the pane and their individual panes.
The pane. If they've lost the vacuum, they need to be fixed.
What if we authorized up to 50 panes?
Okay. And if it goes over that, come back to the board.
Yeah, and maybe he can give us an idea. He didn't indicate how many he thought it would be, but maybe he can give us a ballpark idea.
Well, I think you can look right now. They may be a little dirty, but you don't see the moisture in between the panes. And that's usually you need cold weather for that, but there was some in this room, maybe none in this room, and maybe a few more in this room or less. They were not all, the vacuum had not escaped from that pane in all the windows. It's not talking about replacing every one of them. It's just those that are so bad you can't see through it.
So we're not talking about 100 windows. We're talking about 100. There's four panes in that window?
You've got 549 total panes in the building.
500.
If you replaced 50 panes, that'd be 10% of all the panes. That'd be a $7,500 job, $7,000 job.
$135 a window is what I say was cheap. $135 a paint, that's what cheap.
It's cheap for a whole window.
God, what's wrong with that?
There's nothing wrong with these.
No, that motion that that somebody said set a percentage and come back to court.
Well, after if we go up to a certain amount, we're okay a certain amount, and if we go over that, we need to come back to the court to let us know what we're going to spend it. I personally think we need to fix it. This is the people's courthouse, and we need to keep it to the best shape that we can.
The point that Brian made about the scaffolds are up there. You don't want him to have to come back to court with a scaffold up there and wait.
All right, here's a suggestion to approve Richard Jones to caulk the windows, grills, doors, expansion joints, and replace up to 50 panes at a cost of $135 each, in addition to $14,975 for the caulking job. That's a suggestion.
I'll second that. Second.
Okay, motion by Commissioner Riddle for that, and second by Commissioner Hinton. One more time, Joyce, we're going to approve the $14,975 bid for caulking of the exterior, windows, doors, expansion joints, and authorize the replacement of up to 50 panes at $135 each. All right, all in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? All right, thank you. I think it will really improve the appearance of two of the really dirty sides of this courthouse that really need it. Mm-hmm. Item number 9, did we get anything from the funeral home? Let me tell you briefly about this. Item number 9 is consider and possibly approve payment for a pauper's funeral for Archie Boyd Sr. in the amount of $950. Okay, good. I just happened to see in the paper, and he had brought us this request, I think it was Monday, the day of our last commissioner's court meeting, and it was too late. Court was over, so I put it on here. I noticed in the paper that there was a funeral service in addition to a graveside service for Archie Boyd to be performed by J.C. White Funeral Home. I was a little nervous about that. In fact, here's the obit. Services will be held Saturday, April 9th at Unity Missionary Baptist Church. Interment follow at Westside Cemetery. Well, those two things aren't free, and that's far more than a traditional pauper's funeral. So I asked J.C. White to provide us a statement. He has done that. Here's what I asked him to attest to. J.C. White Funeral and Cremation Services has not received any form of compensation for the funeral services of Mr. Archie Boyd Sr., signed by J.C. White. So again, I didn't know if anything had changed after he had requested this, if the family had come up with money. J.C. is saying no, he doesn't have any money available, and the family has not come up with any money. So there are some family members, but nobody seems to be able to come up with any money.
Make a motion we pay for the $950.
Motion by Commissioner Fields to pay $950 for a pauper's funeral for Archie Ray Boyd, Sr. Second by Commissioner Hinton. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Item number 10, consider and possibly approve a new deputy constable, Brad Duncan, for Precinct 2. And I thought Ray was going to be here today. Maybe he didn't know he was supposed to be, but I thought he would be here. So consider and possibly approve a new deputy constable, Precinct 2. Brad Duncan apparently is, who was Brad employed by?
He was with the city.
He was with the city. Do you know of anything that he's planning on doing? Is the main, as I understand it, the main reason that you might typically do this is to keep your license while you're in between jobs? What would be the...
He went to the city.
Went to the civic center?
Yes, sir.
Still employed by the city then?
Yeah, he's still employed by the city.
But just out of law enforcement?
Commission.
Okay. Say that again. What's the word? Maintain his commission?
Commission, yeah. Yeah. Now our constables, their reserves actually got worked quite a bit. Now, how much you'd have to ask him as far as how much time Brad's going to get out of work.
We can step out and see if you can get a hold of Ray. Well, why don't we see if we can get a hold of Ray and
Ray
maybe come
it,
back to
and
this?
And he recommended that.
Is it volunteer?
Well, I'll get him on the phone if nothing else. Okay. Let's do this and come back. Carolyn's going to see if she can get Ray on the phone. Yeah, number 11, consider and possibly approve hiring of a part-time officer by the Sheriff's Office for Prisoner Transport. Sheriff?
Well, over the past couple of budget years, we've cut a jailer per year because our count was down on prisoners and the feds. I also cut the part-time spot we had in there because the feds just got down to method. Well, business is booming. It's good. That's a good thing for us. Let me ask you.
Out of town business or local business is booming?
Out of town business.
Out of town.
Okay. Yeah, just house business. So actually the money I'm asking for is not it actually comes from the feds pay it because they pay on the transport bill. So but yeah, we've got 28 guests this morning, which is wonderful. That's quite good money every day and over the year it ends up.
Say that figure
again. That's why the include the transport we do, and other things we do.
Do you have this position budgeted and we just haven't taken the money for it?
No, we took it out of the budget because I just didn't need it.
We used to have it in the budget. Okay.
But then our feds went from a good count where it used to be like 30 or 40 to 45. So now we're getting them back. And you know, the feds require us to have two deputies. For anything we do, we pick them up, we take them to the hospital, we take them to court. But they pay for it. I mean, so that's where this money's going to come from. So, but it says here for part-time. Now, these part-times are going to work fine. So what I'd like to do also is have the money available for we can use for overtime. It costs a lot of money if we have to. We need to take a look. We'll try to find somebody for a pattern. Thank you, just that we need to come to the council.
Is it somebody that would just do that? Or they would maybe be available to do other things when you're not? In other words, if you hired a full-time person to do part of it as transports, you got any way to utilize them, or you're going to try to find that half-time person?
No, this is part-time work, or the overtime money is for federal only. Just come in and just transport federal only.
Okay.
Nothing else.
You're talking, we're getting 28 prisoners.
No, we've got 28.
We already got 28, and it could be more.
Oh, yeah.
Okay, and what are you looking at a day?
$45 a day.
$45 a day, and you multiply that.
And then we'll transport only $40 an hour.
When they need that federal prisoner at court, somebody's got to get him, and that's what this part-time.
Well, that's one reason why we got them back.
Or pick them off and move.
We wouldn't want to get any of them pulled from the lockdowns. We're one of the few that survived that are not wrapped in the closure of courts. They won't be closer, and the reason why is because we do take care of them. We take care of the medical. We have a report when they need them there. And so just doing the business with them is paid off.
One thing I want to stress is that they pay, if they're sick and they go to the doctor, they pay for it. If we transport them, they're paying for that.
Well, they don't pay you anything in addition to the $45 to run up to the hospital. I mean, that includes everything, that $45?
No.
They pay you.
If we get $20 an hour per day, it should be $45 to do that, plus mileage.
Plus, we don't pay for it.
No, they pay that too.
Okay. Okay. So when you say they're paying for it, they really are. We're not just taking it out of that additional $45 per head that we're getting.
No.
You get some over and above that.
They do that to make sure we have any of it.
Okay.
Because they understand it is expensive to do it.
Okay.
And that's why they pay us.
Okay. All right.
But I'm trying to hire somebody full time. Actually, if they give us some point, they have to hire somebody full time, it'd be a good thing. Because I think we have a lot more, so the county would be making a lot more money. So be good for us. So hopefully we will be able to hire somebody back. But right now, our part-time, there are only ones who pay full time. If we can't put it part-time.
Where are these prisoners coming from? Any from several different places?
Bowie County, I mean, they come from this county, but most of them Dallas County, where a guy kind of used to marry anywhere in the state of Texas, or since their fans actually look from anywhere.
Do you have his cell number?
But it's getting to the point where
we'll get my phone and I'll send him a text.
Lecture after these, because transport is pretty tough to cover.
Basically, Judge, the additional revenue should cover the cost. And I think
yeah, but it's additional monies from them over and above that $45 per day, right? just for the housing. We get additional transport money. Okay.
Well, it's going to bring in $1,280 a day. That's transporting. We send a bill for that, hospital, all that they pay. It's for us to guard them.
That's just from here.
That's just from October
Okay, what would y'all like to
multiply
do?
Multiply 1,280 by 365 days, and that shows you roughly you take about 25% of the cost of guards and stuff like that.
Yeah, you
got it. Okay, want to make a motion?
Make that motion.
Motion by Commissioner Fields.
I'll second it.
Second by Commissioner Riddle to authorize hiring of a part-time officer to do prisoner transport.
Hey, Judge, we have a problem finding a part-time. You just go to work and work out the money there.
Ask the guy that made your motion, is that okay?
In other words, he needs to know, if he can't find a part-time person, he's just gonna pay overtime to his people that are there.
Right now, we've got a part-time person.
One thing about these feds, when they need them, and we need to transport them. But you've got a person now, part-time?
Right now.
Yeah, that's where our budget.
Okay. If you come up and need to do the overtime later on without that part-time person, we could just come back to the court.
Okay.
Would you come up there?
$15,000, I think, covered. Probably do something back, I'd say $15,000.
So I'll add $15,000 for part-time,
Okay. So you're saying authorize the part-time now and authorize full-time later?
If we need to.
If we need to.
Well, he'll come back to you if he's full-time, because you're right, he's like.
Yeah. Yeah.
I'll wait for full-time, just for,
Let's do, or if you're not unable to hire a part-time and you come up with a situation where we need to approve a full-time, then let's do that.
I think it'd be cheaper or less, it'd be better, just to bring where you didn't talk over that budget.
Look, I didn't wanna get you when you're sitting there on the conference table.
Well, what, and, you know, we're looking, we've got 28 prisoners right now. We end up with 50 or 75 prisoners, you're gonna see a big. Yeah, and you can end up with five, that's right. You can't plan on it, you can't count on it, but if you do it like this, it really works, it helps the county.
We just put $15,000 more in this budget.
Right.
I'll put it eventually in part-time, so we got the money.
Okay, that's good.
Okay, got a motion and a second for the approval of this position part-time. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Okay, I'm gonna jump back now to the item regarding a new deputy constable. I've got Ray Barrett here, and Ray was indisposed. Ray, can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
Let's see here, let me see if I can turn this up. Okay, can you tell us a little bit about your plan here with Brad Duncan?
Okay, I spoke with Brad, he's police officer at the city. From Mount Pleasant, has been working there for quite a few years, and he has recently left the police department and taken a job with the Civic Center. But he was wanting to try to keep his commission held, and so he called me and asked me about it. It wouldn't be anything that would require any additional monies for doing anything. It's just would give us another deputy to come out once in a while when we needed help. And it would also help him by carrying his commission. We wouldn't need any additional cars or anything like that.
Okay, so you do not need additional cars or equipment?
No, sir. No, sir.
Has he said about how many hours he would anticipate making himself available?
Well, what I generally try to do is make them at least come out and work 8 hours a month, and that's something he would be able to do. But he would also come out any other time that we needed him if I called him. You know, if we had some kind of special event going on where we needed a little extra security or something like that. He would be able to do something like that also. But he would put in at least 8 hours a month that would be required by the office.
Okay. Commissioners, anybody have a question for Ray?
We do carry our reserves by the office.
Yeah. That's right. We would be adding him at whatever the rate is. We were just talking about adding him to our work compensation, Ray, which I think is a minimal cost. Okay.
Okay.
Anybody have a question?
Ray had talked to me a little bit about this, and I certainly don't have a problem with it, but we would have to pay the workman's comp on it.
Okay, Ray.
He's a very seasoned officer. He's the supervisor with the police department. He's a good decision maker. Got a lot of good qualities he would bring to the department also.
All right. Y'all ready for a motion on that?
Make that motion.
Motion by Commissioner Fields to authorize bringing on Brad Duncan as a new deputy constable.
Second.
Second by Commissioner Hinton. Ray, thank you very much. That's all we need.
All right, I appreciate it. Thank you very much.
All in favor of that, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Item number 12, let's see, we got 10, 11. Consider and possibly submit a local transportation project to Northeast Texas Regional Mobility Authority for possible funding. Okay. We've talked about this the last couple of meetings. For those of you that don't know it, Bob Ratcliffe retired from TxDOT Atlanta effective the end of March. So I've picked up this conversation with Deanne Simmons and Dennis Beckham. And we bounced around three different projects. And I told her that really the commissioners felt like FM 1735, that College Road, was still a priority for us. And we had money set aside for right-of-way purchase, but really had no idea if we had enough money. Utility costs to move those utilities always seems to be more than you anticipate. And they talked about it. We talked about it again. They talked about it some more. And a week ago, last Monday, they agreed that they would move this project up in their priority list if we were successful at getting some net RMA money on the College Road project. So I thought that was good news. I don't know that they'll commit necessarily any more money to it, and I don't know that it's going to happen next year, but I believe that they would move it into their 2017 or 18 schedule to begin this project. So I thought that was a win for us. So this would be the project I would like to submit to NetRMA for funding to see if we can get some of that up to $400,000. And I need to apply for this by the 15th, which is Friday.
We need a motion for that.
If that's the project you're comfortable with as opposed to other projects, I mean, money's money wherever we put it, but if you all still think that 1735, the College Road, is still a project that we want to push for, here's an opportunity to push for it and make it possibly a reality sooner than it was scheduled for. So yes, I'd like a motion.
You know, this is the reason we agreed to do it back in early 2000.
Yeah.
Because it is a priority to us. We had kids that were killed out there, and we went ahead and made it and put turning lanes in there. And since that's been done, we have not lost a student out there. But the road going to the college and by Chapel Hill is narrow, and we need those shoulders and stuff on there. Now, part of that has already been done mm-hmm. because of 4,000, so that's going to be a big savings right there.
Yep.
But whatever money we can get to help promote this and go forward, I'd like to see it done.
Yeah, and the loop and work that was done on this road puts us that much further ahead on this, because now you've got nearly a mile of 1735 that's been improved. So I think that's another plus for pushing for this project.
Judge, I make a motion that we approve.
Motion by Commissioner Parker to submit 1735 to NetRMA for possible funding.
Second.
Second by Commissioner Hinton. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Item 13. If you'll recall back about 6 weeks ago, you authorized CBG Surveying, that's the old Conley and Associates that are based out of Sulphur Springs, to come and do the final cleanup work on surveying and the right-of-way corrections related to 2348. 271, they have agreed to do and could do it during the time that they're here working on 2348 at a cost of $7,520. Significantly more than 2348, but obviously a much bigger project than 2348. So this will, once they are finished with this and 2348, that will wrap up the last few details before we are given final sign-off to enable us to get our maximum semi-annual funding, or at least our minimum semi-annual funding from TxDOT.
When did they say they could start on this?
They're ready to go.
Okay.
They're ready to go.
I'm ready to do it. I make that motion.
Okay. Motion by Commissioner Fields to approve CBG to complete the surveying and right-of-way corrections on 271 as part of the loop project. Need a second. Second by Commissioner Hinton. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Item number 14. Would you pass me those parking lot figures? There's two of those, one for you, one for Al. In working on the Ratliff building and in just looking at what new parking lot striping and handicap spots we needed, it was obvious to me we needed more than just that. None of the spaces over there at the JP's office or anywhere on the bell tower block, in fact, have the proper signage other than one spot. The logos have worn off of the pavement. There are no suitable handicap spots for the new Ratliff building now that we have reconfigured the entrance on Madison Street. We are trying to eliminate that back west door that was previously the handicap entrance. For security purposes, we're making the entrance be on the Madison Street side. And we will put a crash bar there on the west side so that only outgoing traffic can come in that door. And so we really need some appropriate handicap spots to serve the needs of people coming to pay their taxes or to sign up to vote or to register a car. And that would be a logical place to do that would be there on the south east corner of that parking lot, as close to the entry door off of Madison as we can get. I contacted two local stripers, one here in town, and the next closest one that I knew about is a fella out of Nash. I've never worked with him. I have just heard other people tell me about him. Roy's Striping is no longer in business since Mr. Roy passed away. I only received a response from one, from the gentleman from Nash, Precision Parking Lot Striping. I met with him last week, and we, together with Judy Cook and Judge Dyke and Judge McNutt and Constable Durant, we walked that parking lot, and Mike Thompson with Precision Parking Lot Striping gave us his suggestions, and here they are. I'm going to talk about these one at a time. Paint a blue background with white steel, with a white wheelchair emblem. Add two signs, and he's talking about metal stand-up signs, and four concrete wheel stops to protect those signs. Add a cross out one spot for a van unload zone, and add a crosswalk from handicap spots to the building. So this is a mouthful, but what he's doing is adding two handicap spots there on the southernmost, easternmost corner of the bell tower, just north about 30 feet from the entry door on Madison Street. So he's going to eliminate three regular parking places and replace it with two handicap spots. These will have metal signs, as is appropriate according to the law, and one of those spots will be van accessible. He'll have concrete wheel stops to protect those signs, and then put a crosswalk going from the parking area, crossing that entrance off of Madison Street where cars whip in there on the north side of the building. He felt like, and I agree, that it's a good place to put some kind of painted protective crosswalk there for traffic that's foot traffic that's walking from the parking lot to the entry door. So that's item one. The next one would be to mount two posts on either side of the walkway on the west end of tax collection. We also have a situation where automobile traffic is turning in to the old, I'll call it the driveway, in the back or on the west end of the Ratliff building where Leonard used to park and now Chrissy occasionally parks. But some people, and this is, they've seen it on two different occasions, and one of Judy's employees nearly got hit the other day. They will pull into that spot off of, what is that street? Johnson? What's on the north side of the post office? What? It's not Johnson. It's Arkansas?
Arkansas.
Is that Arkansas?
Yes.
Eastbound traffic on Arkansas will turn into that old driveway, and then when they're ready to leave, they'll just take a left, drive over the curb to go into the bell tower parking lot, aiming towards, and it's not a solid curb. There is about a 5-foot gap there in that curb, and there's no hedges there where, I admit, it's tempting. If somebody doesn't see the curbs, it looks like, well, this is a logical place to go. Well, one of the ladies that was getting out of her car and coming, walking that way to come in the back door of the Ratliff building, you know, nearly got hit. So we want to eliminate the ability for a car to leave that driveway and enter in and drive out of that driveway, cross over the flower bed and the curb heading towards the JP offices by putting two metal poles there that will be concreted in about 5 feet apart so that no vehicle can go through there. They can certainly park back there, but they can't drive through there and leave the driveway and enter into the parking area. Item three, paint the curbs yellow. Paint a top and face of steps. And here what we're talking about is that set of steps there where voters coming to early voting have to go up those steps. And those steps run down Arkansas, and then they cut into the corner of the elections office there. And there's no kind of, there is a one handrail there, but there's no safety paint there. So this would be to paint a yellow stripe on top of each of those three steps where foot traffic comes up the steps to vote and maybe goes back down the steps into the driveway area. Item number four is to paint the word reserved on the front of the parking spaces in back of the Justice Center and paint stripes to identify those parking places. But the judges over there have attempted to keep the public from parking there, but oftentimes the general public who is going over to the neighboring businesses will park there. You can no longer read the word reserved that they had painted there years ago. It worked for a while, but now you can't read it. And so they have got a couple of signs back there in a concrete bucket. But they feel like if you put the word reserved all along those spaces in the back to identify those as parking for JP employees. Next item is add two handicap spots on either side of the ramp in front of the Justice Center. Right now there are no handicap spots there. So we would add one on either side of the entry ramp, cross out the, there's two little small unusable spaces there on either side of the railing, and put two signs on the building to make these be the two handicap parking spots for those going into the Justice Center. The next item was a suggestion by the JP staff, paint a center dividing line that would run north and south there in front of the JP office for traffic that is cutting through from the post office to Billy Craig and vice versa, to just identify, hey, don't drive right down the middle. You drive on the right and you drive on the other side so that we can have traffic that's not running into each other. The next would be to black out the old handicap spots. We've got some handicap spots that are somewhere between the entry door to the JP's office and the bell tower, somewhat of an awkward location. We're trying to accommodate handicap spots for those using the JP building and those going into the elections administration office, and eliminate those that are no longer functional. They don't have any logos on, and there's no pole signage on them, so we'll just black those out. And then lastly, somewhat of an option, but if you're going to do it, it would be nice to restripe the whole Justice Center parking lot just to freshen up the lines over there. They're okay. They're at about 50% life. So there you go. There's a laundry list. It was all agreed upon by everyone in attendance there. $1,982 to do all of that.
Judge, on that paint on the reserve Justice Center and the paint and the stripe restricted reserve.
This is on the back side.
Back side.
Yes.
That I think all the time, if they have a juvenile, they can't bring them in the front. They bring them in the back, because they're juveniles, and that'll go straight to the judges, either Judge McNutt or Judge Dine. And I know they use that a lot, and that's the reason.
They do, and that was her point. It's not only for the employees of the two JPs, it's for the officers that do use those rear entrances a lot, they said.
Well, it looks like to me a lot of thought was put into it, and all parties are involved, and it needs to be done. I make that motion.
Motion by Commissioner Fields to approve this one and only price from Precision Parking Lot Striping.
Second.
Second by Commissioner Riddle. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? All right, thank you. Item number 15, consider and possibly approve allowing Precinct 2 to sell some surplus items. Commissioner Fields, what have you got to sell?
Okay, Judge, I have four items that it's some point in time in different, this is a time of year, like a ditching machine. This is an old ditching machine. It's probably 14, 15 years old. Used it a lot, but it does not fit on my tractor that I have now. Also, I have a sickle, what they call a sickle, cuts the limbs. It's kind of like cutting hay, but it goes up, and that is old, and I don't need that. We've got everything cut back, and what we use is just our regular cutter now, and it's 14, 15 years old. Then I've got a used 15-foot bush hog rhino that I want to sell. It's pretty well wore out. And then I'm looking at this cat loader. It's a 1978. We've used it. I've had it reworked about 15 years ago, the motor, the transmission and stuff, and I'd like to sell that at this time, but I will not sell it right away. I'm going to use it a little bit more, but if it gets to the point where I think I need to sell it, I'm going to sell it.
How are you going to sell these? Through Auctioneer Express?
Auction.
All of it?
Yes. Through
Auctioneer Express?
Yes, sir.
Okay. All right. Would y'all give Commissioner Fields permission to do that?
So I get moved.
Motion by Commissioner Parker and second by Commissioner Hinton. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Item 16 is to consider and possibly approve obtaining some prisoners to help clean up the Long Cemetery.
Hey, Judge, what we have here, this is a cemetery that's out on 899. Just as you go through Farmers Academy, past the Beetle Shop, just as you get to the railroad track, there's a cemetery on the right. There's probably 9-10 graves out there, not many. There's no organization, there's no family member that I know of that takes care of it or attends to it. What has happened in the last 6 months, we try to clean it up once a year because there's nobody taking care of it and try to, you know, make it look nice and weed eating and stuff like that as we can. There's nobody that I know of that looks after it or takes care of it. And somebody went in there and had some sheetrock, not a lot of it, but just dumped it in there, and there's five grave markers kicked over. John Fitch has helped me before in situations where there's nobody, no family, nobody to help take care of this, and John will go back in there and put those. We're going to look at it, and I know the sheriff has been out there. Y'all looked at not a lot of stuff out there, but we can bring our smaller dump truck or a dump truck and pick that up real quick. It's not a whole lot of it. But I just wanted the court to be aware before we did anything what the problem is out there. And there was a good article in the paper this week that dealt with that. And people see people pulling in or something like this. What we're going to try to do is there's a pipe up there. Somebody, or the lock got cut off of it. I'm probably going to buy a lock and put on it and keep people from pulling up in there. That way, if the sheriff's department comes by and somebody's pulled out there at the gate, they can stop and look. But it's very upsetting to go to a cemetery where there's markers and people have knocked over the markers. Now, that's just not right. And we all, I know, feel that way, but you don't desecrate it. Somebody's grave or do things like that. That's wrong. And I think it was probably young people that was involved in that. But we do have, I talked to a lot of people over there, and they're going to be watching that cemetery. We see lights in there at night, or we see something going on, they're going to call. They'll call me or Tim and let them know somebody's down there. So. But anyway, I would like permission from the court.
Sheriff, is that something y'all have done before?
Yes, sir. As long as there's not a board regulating the cemetery, it's one of the commissioners actually take care of, and we are allowed to go through and have to do that.
Okay.
This would qualify for that.
Okay.
We just have to have permission from the commissioner's court. All commissioners.
Well, I've got a couple. I keep them cleaned up.
Yes, sir.
I do like my own. Yeah.
Well, since there was destruction there, we got the sheriff's department, since they knocked over the markers. But I'm going to talk to John Fitch. I'm going to see if he will help us get those set back up. But the sheriff's going to help us on cleaning it up this time, the sheetrock and stuff that they throw down. But there's no organized board. There's no family members that I know of.
All I need is a motion.
So moved.
Motion by Commissioner Hinton to allow Commissioner Fields to head up a team, including prisoners, to clean up the Long Cemetery. Second by Commissioner Fields. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Item number 17, consider and possibly approve the transfer of title of a 98 model F-350 truck to Precinct 4. From who? Is that the one that was the what was that? What was that vehicle? Fire department vehicle?
Yes, it was one that the city had that was turned back in to the county.
It's title in the city's name now?
I don't know if it was ever changed over. Do y'all know if it was ever changed over back into our name after they give it back to us? Okay. But what my two patch trucks have got 150 to 180,000 miles on them. The truck that I've got that is under my ditch clean out machine is not heavy enough really to pull that machine. And what I want to do is take that truck and put under it, this fire truck, and take the one that's under it now and have the bed changed, the dump bed, flat bed pulled off, the dump bed put back on to use it as a, one of my patch trucks. It don't have but like 35,000 miles on it. It's a 90, I think it's a 96 model is what it is. And, but it don't have like 35,000 miles on it, so it'd be good for, you know, for patch truck. But it's just not quite heavy enough to pull that ditching machine. We've been doing it with it for a long time, but I saw this opportunity to, you know, to make some changes there and to save some money on repairs.
And that's the vehicle that months ago I'd asked y'all to go up and look and see if anybody was interested in using it because the city wanted us to do something with it. Okay. Where is it? Is it still physically with the city, or do you have it now?
It's at the county barn.
It's at the county barn. Okay, you just want to transfer the title if it's not already in the county's name.
Yes.
Okay.
Do you have something?
No. I thought the one a couple of 3 months ago was that other. There's two out there.
There's two. One of them is a tanker truck.
Right. And I thought that's the one.
Nobody's interested in it. Right. This is the other one ton that's there.
Okay. Need a motion.
I make a motion to transfer that.
Motion to transfer the title of the 98 model F-350 to Precinct 4.
Second.
Second by Commissioner Hinton. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Item number 18. Travel and seminars. Consider and possibly approve. I did not have any submitted. Is that correct? Don't have any? Item number 19, approve oral and written reports. Motion by Commissioner Hinton for approval. Second by Commissioner Fields. All in favor of approving oral and written reports, say aye.
Aye.
Item number 20, consider possibly approve treasurer's report.
Approve treasurer's report.
Motion by Commissioner Hinton for approval.
Second.
Second by Commissioner Parker. All in favor of approving the treasurer's report, say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Item number 21, approve budget amendments.
I don't think y'all got to see that one, but it's $1,319 moving from other expense to computer expense.
Just
to buy that laptop.
For one laptop or two laptops.
And if I do more than one, I've also got one, maybe.
$1,300.
$1,300 would be more than one, unless it was one.
Okay, that is the one and only approval. That's not any new money that's moving from other expense to computer expense for the, for the district court. Okay. Need approval on that budget amendment?
Make a motion to approve budget.
Motion by Commissioner Hinton to approve this.
Second.
Second by Commissioner Parker. All in favor of approval of this one budget amendment number 10, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Item 22, sign pay orders and approve payments.
Make a motion to pay bills.
Second.
Motion by Commissioner Hinton, second by Commissioner Fields for approval on paying bills. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? All right, item 23, closing comments. Related to our building project across the street, well, first of all, Sonia came in a little bit late, and let me explain why Sonia came in late. She's trying to cover, what, about three commissioners' courts all on the same day, and she feels that it's more important to be at Pittsburgh at 8:30. I know, I was going to clarify. They actually start 30 minutes earlier than we do, and how on earth they get done that quickly, I don't know, but they do. And so Sonia is just telling us that this is going to be a regular thing, and she would like to be able to come in, and at some point, if she has any public comment, if we might recognize her and give her the ability to make a comment after our standard time for public comment. And I know that she's got something today, so I'm going to allow her to do it at this time.
I live in Cal County, so it does make sense for me to start here, but Titus County is home to me, so, but thank you for the time. This will not be a standing thing, but I did want to just make the announcement that the Tri-County Press will be hosting a political forum this Thursday at the City Center, starting at 6 p.m. It will be for the city council candidates, all the city council candidates, and we've also invited the Titus Regional Medical Center Board of Managers. We will allow time for...
What about, and water board, too? Water board?
Well, we will, yes, we will allow time for, and I've got to contact those individuals, because several have asked since then, since we set the date and contacted the other candidates, if we'll allow time for them. So I'll be contacting them as well as runoff election candidates for commissioner. So, but we wanted to devote the majority of our time to city council, that have not had a forum, as well as the Board of Managers for the hospital. So that will be this Thursday.
What time?
6 p.m.
6 p.m. at the Civic Center.
At the Civic Center. And we just feel this is a good service to the community. We're going to be doing other such events like this, just as a way to better inform our community. We are currently not printing our weekly paper, the English version, but we are working and have been working on several printed publications in Spanish for our local community, as in response to what local advertisers are saying they want. So just know that we are working to revamp some things, but we definitely want to continue to be a vital part of this community. So I'm going to leave flyers here, so if you'd like to pick them up, if you have other questions.
If you want to put one of those on the courthouse doors, you can do that. I think they're already there. That's right, I did see that.
Which I would appreciate.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
And in the future, if you'll just kind of give me a heads up, maybe before the meeting, if you have something that you want to say, or if I'll try to remember to look at you. That's all right. Okay, first item, our construction project over across the street, handicap ramp. If you'll remember, this was the second part of that project, was to approve going ahead and installing a handicap ramp on the west side of the Witt Building there as part of the exterior remodel there, mostly on the front and the front corner of the building. And Richard is really watching out for us. He does a good job, and he brought to my attention the fact that Jacob Hatfield and Mike Ahrens, he got them to come down and look at the situation. Because there is that curve in where there at one time were some parking places, I guess, on that west side of the building, and now there's some plastic posts that are there. That, where that curves in, reduces the width of that available sidewalk. If he goes and installs the appropriate width handicap ramp, he's going to eat up all but a small sliver of that entire width of sidewalk. As you know, the redoing sidewalks up here have just completed a couple of segments of that, and we'll be continuing to do that work. It is the city's request that we reconsider, at least for the time being, that handicap ramp because of the fact that it will impede foot traffic going up and down the east side of Madison Street there if we put this handicap ramp in. And again, we don't even know what we're going to do with that building. The handicap ramp, as I recall, when we made this decision was, oh, well, let's go ahead and do it at the same time rather than breaking that up. But we have a practicality issue here, and Mike Ahrens and Jacob feel like it would be good if we could postpone that part of the project. And Richard called me to tell me about this and said, hey, I'll give you a deduct on this project if you all want to remove that for the time being. When they redo the sidewalks at some point in the future and perhaps widen that sidewalk back out and remove that inset where the parking places were, we would have plenty of room there. Now, all that could change if we got a tenant or some other use for that building where there was an obvious need. But he has marked off over there where the handicap ramp would be. You can see a stripe that he has popped along that east wall of the building, and you can see where that handicap ramp would be. There's one flat line that's just a level, and then there's one angled line if you want to go over there and take a look at it. But I'm in agreement with Richard and Mike and Jacob that we don't necessarily have to scrap this whole idea, but let's not do it right now and wait until we've got more width on that sidewalk before we eliminate most of that sidewalk with this handicap ramp. If y'all want to go and look at that, but just give me some guidance as to what to tell Richard. I told Richard to please hold off until at least today until I could get some direction from you. So before I go to my second item, what are your thoughts on that?
Judge, we agreed to do that. And if you remember the last thing we talked about, I said we need to get with Jacob and see what the plans are in the future down through there. If they widen that and take out those parallel parking areas there, you will have sufficient room where you can do the ramp, plus you can have a sidewalk. Right now, I agree with them. If we do what we are fixing to do, you're going to have very limited access to that sidewalk. And this is one of the main reasons the Main Street project and their plans for the future, I think we need to coincide with them to make it all come together. So I don't have a bit of problem with just holding off on that until we get further along, because they are coming this way with that sidewalk, and at some point in time, we don't want to do something and turn around and have to tear it out or something. Let's just wait and see what the plans are.
In fact, if you had anybody parking in the back of the annex that was handicapped, you couldn't get a walker or a wheelchair.
That's correct.
Through there.
Back up heading north, because there'd be no sidewalk left. And it's not a two-way ramp, it was just a one-way ramp coming from the north going up to the south. Anybody else have a problem holding off on this and me asking Richard to work us up a deduct that we could look at and approve at the next meeting?
I have no problem.
Okay. A reminder, second item I have is the TAC loss prevention funds that were mentioned at our last meeting. I can't ask for money if I don't know what you want to use it for. I would like to ask for about $6,000 to provide us with four defibrillator kits, you know, the emergency heart, I'm not sure what it's called. It's called an AED, but I think we should have one in this building, in the annex, in the Ratliff building, and at the Ag Extension office. Maybe that's overkill, maybe it's not. They're about $1,500 a piece at a discount, according to the price that Bobby Spearman quoted me for the one that was donated to the JP offices. So we have one in the JP offices, and this is a nice one that matches up well with the emergency folks coming from the hospital. But four of those at about $1,500 would be $6,000. And as you'll recall, there's some funds available for you, for the sheriff, and some funds available for you. So again, the quicker we ask for it, the better our chances of being approved. So I'm going to go ahead and ask for the heart attack kits. If y'all want to come up with something else, loss prevention, anything in the loss prevention arena would be considered.
With safety glasses, cones, rope.
Yeah, or something bigger or something smaller, but that would be one thing. But let's not let this money just go to waste and not even ask for it. That's all I have. Commissioner Riddle, do you have anything? Commissioner Fields?
I wanted to mention, you know, Crayford, they have the distant races with the horses and stuff. They had 103 horses competing Saturday. And I thought that was really neat. I went out and watched a little of it, but that brings a lot of, for each horse that's racing, you're probably going to have from 6 to 8 caregivers or families that's here. They can get here several days before. They stay here a day or two later, so you can look at about a week of spending. That's a lot of people coming into this area, spending money and buying meals and gas and staying at motels and things like that. But there was 103 horses. I think they had a 25-mile race and a 50-mile race. I don't know if I'd want to stay on a horse that long, but but anyway, it's really neat, and I thought that was appreciate Freeford's bill sponsoring that and being involved in that. That's a good deal, and it really brings a lot of money in. And I just wanted to warn everybody, there's snakes out. Be careful what you pick up. I picked up a big old, well, about 6-inch log and a cottonmouth under that thing, and my heart, I thought I might need one of the defibrillators. I said, it scared me. But snakes are out. That's all I have.
Commissioner Parker?
I have nothing, Judge.
Commissioner Hinton?
Yes, Judge. I want to go back out on bids for that head wall, County Road 3375. Didn't receive no bids. I'm going to try to go to some people personally and get them to meet with me and put a bid in on it.
Okay.
I'm going to try one more time. And another issue, we've got gentleman is out there at the maintenance barn. Our tires, our pile of tires is very mountainous at this time. But I've been trying to call that place out of Paris, and I haven't got no call back yet. So we will need to do something about those pretty quick. But I'm going to keep trying to call them and see if we can't get those tires disposed of or get a price list of what it's going to cost us.
May check with the other big tire guys in town and ask them who they use.
We had a place out of Louisiana coming and picking them up, but I think they went out of business. I think this bunch that I'm talking to out of Paris, that's pretty well who everybody uses. So, but I'll check around, and if y'all have any ideas, let me know. And one other thing that was brought up, and I don't know if it would do us any good to possibly get a shredder or anything for ourselves. So, be something to think about.
A tire shredder.
Tire shredder.
Tire shredder.
Those are pretty expensive, aren't they?
Yeah, that's the thing about it. I don't know if it'd be justifiable to do it or not.
But I can't imagine it would.
Sheriff's Department, many tires there. I mean, we go year to year.
What do you do with that shredded material once you have it?
Depends on...
It can go to the landfill.
It can go to landfill after it's been shredded.
And the way it works with these companies that pick up the tires, do they pay you anything? Do you pay them?
You pay them.
You pay them to haul them off?
You pay them to haul them off.
Well, like, what would it cost to haul that pile that you got out there right now?
Depending on the type. Depending on the type of tire, say regular car tire, I think it's like $2 a piece. Truck tires, $5. Tractor tires, $7, $8. Just depending on the type of tire it is.
How long has it been since we've had them picked up?
Been about last time we did it.
2 years.
About 2 years.
Two and a half years.
That's all, and you got that many tires now.
Well, between that and the ones we pick up off the roads and stuff like that, bring up our...
And from our county cleanup.
And our county cleanup and stuff.
County cleanup.
So...
Okay.
We haul, three or four dump truck loads from the dump up there last year from our county cleanup.
Okay. All right. If there's nothing else, I'll entertain a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Motion, Commissioner Hinton, second Commissioner Parker, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
All right. Thank you.